Hello guys, I am Vishali Kikan and we are discussing chemistry. Today we are going to cover two chapters, stoichiometry in the chemical reactions and water and solutions. So first of all, we are going to start with the chapter stoichiometry in the chemical reactions. And first of all, we are going to understand what is a reaction yield. To understand the various kind of yields, we must understand theoretical yield, actual yield and the percentage yield. So these three types of yield we are going to understand the reaction yield. First of all, what is a theoretical yield? Theoretical yield is the amount, or I can say mass, of product predicted based on the stoichiometry of the chemical equation. We are going to see the stoichiometry of the chemical equation and we are going to see theoretically what is the mass or amount of the product that must be formed for a given reactant. Similarly, we have the actual yield. In the actual yield, as the name suggests, it is the amount or mass of the product actually collected during the experiment or industrial processes. Sometimes actual yield is lesser than the theoretical yield. Theoretical yield is the maximum possible amount of the product that is formed for a given reactant. So here you can see we have various types of reactions. We must understand what is the forward reaction and the reverse reaction. Like here we have nitrogen gas N2 in the gaseous form plus hydrogen in the gaseous form, 3H2 in the gaseous form is going to react to form 2NH3 ammonia in the gaseous form. So here if N2 plus 3H2 is combining to form the NH3 gas, it is a forward reaction, whereas if NH3 is dissociating to form N2 and 3H2, it's a reverse reaction, right? Now here in this reaction, we have the actual yield and the theoretical yield. Theoretical yield can be calculated by looking at the equation, and actual yield by actually seeing what is the amount of NH3 produced when N2 and H2 are combined, right? Now coming to the material lost. When we have the actual yield is lesser than the theoretical yield, some of the material is lost. How the material is lost? Material is lost, it means actual yield is lesser than the theoretical yield. Material is lost by some phenomena like spillage during the transfer. If I am talking about solution and solutions are transferred from one beaker or one container to the another, so what will happen? We can have the spillage of the solutions as well, and this can account for the material lost. Similarly, we have splattering during the heating and the losses during the isolation and the purification of my substances. So whenever I want to do the isolation or the purification of the product, that time also material can get lost and the actual yield will be lesser than the theoretical yield. So how to improve, how to make the actual yield nearly equal to the theoretical yield? So we can use the improved skills. We can improve our skills, we can have the better equipments, and we can reduce the number of steps in the procedure. And according to these three points, we can reduce the losses and we can improve the actual yield. So what is the percentage yield? This, it is the ratio. It is expressed as the percentage, as the name suggests. What is the percentage of actual yield to the theoretical yield? So percentage yield is actual yield upon theoretical yield into 100, right? So coming to a question based upon this. So methanol, CH3OH, can be made in a synthesis reaction using carbon dioxide and hydrogen. So CO2 gas plus 3H2 gas gives CH3OH in the liquid plus H2O in the gaseous form. So during an investigation, it is found that 20 gram of hydrogen was reacted with excess carbon dioxide to produce 102 gram of methanol. What is the percentage yield of this reaction? To find out the percentage yield, the actual yield is given, actual amount of methanol that is produced by reaction of hydrogen and carbon dioxide, it is given. So amount of hydrogen that is reacted, it is given. Amount of methanol that is produced, it is given. So we can find out from the amount of hydrogen what should be the amount of the methanol produced from the given equation. According to the given equation, what would be the amount of methanol produced, that we can find out. CO2 in the gaseous form plus 3H2 in the gaseous form gives CH3OH in the liquid form plus H2 in the gaseous form. So here this hydrogen amount is given, it is 20 gram, and CO2 is in excess. So we have to see what is the limiting reagent, which is my hydrogen, and according to that I am going to find out the amount of CH3OH that is required, right? So that can be produced when I have 20 gram of hydrogen. right? That would be my theoretical yield. Actual yield is 102 gram, right? So now here we can find out the molecular mass of H2, that is 2.02 gram per mole. Molecular mass of CH3OH also we can find out. So that is 32.05 gram per mole, right? And now from the molecular masses, I can find out the number of moles. Number of moles of H2 is equal to 20.0 gram multiplied with 1 mole upon 2.02 gram. So it is 20 gram divided by the molecular mass, which is 2.02 gram per mole. So 1 mole is taken in numerator. Right, so here you can see we have found out the number of moles of hydrogen, which is 9.9010 mole, right? And from here I can find out the number of moles of methanol produced. So here you can see the number of moles of methanol produced would be 1 by 3 times of the number of moles of H2. Here the coefficient is 1 and here the coefficient for hydrogen is 3. So if I have 3 times the number of moles of hydrogen, we are producing 1 mole of CH3OH. So okay, we have 9.9010 mole of hydrogen. It is producing 9.9010 mole of hydrogen into 1 mole of CH3OH divided by 3 mole of hydrogen. So here we can form 3.3003 mole of CH3OH. Now from the 3.3003 mole, I know the number of moles, I know the molar mass, I can find out the mass of the CH3OH produced theoretically. So mass of CH3OH is equal to 3.3003 mole into 30.05 gram per mole, which is the molar mass, right? So over here we will multiply these two, I will find out 105.78 gram. This is the amount of methanol theoretically produced. The amount of methanol actually produced considering the losses also is 102 gram. So percentage yield, we know the formula, actual yield upon theoretical yield into 100%. So what is the actual yield? 102.0 gram. What is the theoretical yield? We have already calculated it, 105.78 gram into 100, that is my 96.4%. Now coming to the next concept, which is based upon the next chapter, the water and solution. So here the first concept is dissolving of ionic compound, right? So here we are considering the any of the ionic compound, and we will consider the sodium chloride, which is an ionic compound, and we are dissolving in it in water, right? So examine dissolving process at the molecular level. For molecular level, first of all we have to break the crystal. We are going to break the crystal. So after breaking the crystal, we are going to examine this dissolving, right? So water, we know water is a highly polar compound, right? So water will be having oxygen and hydrogen. Oxygen is now negatively polarized, right? And hydrogen is positively polarized. So if I dissolve NaCl, NaCl will be composed of ion, sodium ion, which is the positive ion, and chloride ion, which is the negative ion. Oxygen is attracted to the positively charged sodium ion, right? Oxygen is the negatively charged pole of the H2O molecule, and hydrogen is the positively charged pole of the H2O molecule. It is attracted to the negatively charged chloride ion. So now coming to the hydration. Hydration means the process in which ions are surrounded by the water molecule. You can see how we have the dissolving of the ionic compound. We had considered the case of NaCl, and when the water is surrounding the given ions, it is called the hydration. Now coming to the dissociation. First of all, the separation of individual ion from the ionic compound as it dissolves in water takes place. Like if I have NaCl, I told you it is dissociated into Na positive and Cl negative ions, right? So now coming to the question based upon it, write a chemical equation for the dissociation of potassium phosphate. First of all, I should know what is the potassium phosphate molecular formula. So potassium phosphate molecular formula is K3PO4. So first of all, we have to find out the number of each ions in the compound. So if I see potassium ions, we have 3 potassium ions, 3 K positive, and one we have the phosphate ion, so PO4, 3 negative ion. Then we can find out the chemical equation. According to the chemical equation, we have K3PO4. K3PO4 is going to dissociate into the 3 K positive aqueous ions plus PO4, 3 negative aqueous ions. So K3PO4 in solid gives 3 K positive aqueous plus PO4-3 negative aqueous is the dissociation equation. Right, now coming to the dissolving of molecular compound. Now in the molecular compound we have the two possibilities: the compound is miscible or compound is immiscible. So now here we have the various molecular compound. We are going to see these are miscible or immiscible. So for that we should understand what is miscible. Miscible are the compounds which are able to mix to form a solution. Right, so it is usually describing liquids that mix with each other and in all of the proportion to form a solution. So we have some miscible compounds that are mixing with each other in all of the proportion to form a solution, whereas if I have immiscible compound, these are unable to mix to form a solution. They will never mix with each other, usually describing liquid that don't readily mix with each other. Now coming to the hydrogen bond, so mostly we have some compound, the molecular compound, which are combined with the help of hydrogen bond. Hydrogen bond explain the dissolving of alcohol and glucose in water. So alcohol and glucose are the molecular compound which are dissolved in water, right? So it is composed of carbon, hydrogen and oxygen. So you can see the oxygen and hydrogen will create a polar end and it is going to form the hydrogen bond with the water molecule, and in this manner alcohol is going to dissolve in the water with the hydrogen bond. So coming to the concept of like dissolves like. Like dissolve like is a concept where solvent-solute attraction must overcome the attraction between the both solute and the solvent in order to dissolve the solute. So solute-solvent attraction should be higher, right? It should overcome the solute-solute and solvent-solvent attraction. So solute-solute is having attraction with each other, solvent-solvent will having attraction with each other. These two will have the higher attraction. Solute and solvent attraction is higher than solute-solute attraction and solvent-solvent attraction, right? So when this will happen, we will be having the miscible solutions. At that time, the dissolving will happen in between solute and solvent. Now, what is like dissolve like? If I have the polar covalent compound or the ionic compound, polar covalent compound and the ionic compound are dissolved in the polar solvent. The polar solvent will be having such a property that the solute-solvent attraction is greater than the solvent-solvent attraction and the solute-solute attraction. Similarly, if I talk about the non-polar solvent are not dissolved in the polar solvent, because here the solute-solute attraction or the solvent-solvent attraction is greater than the solute-solvent attraction, but these are readily dissolved in non-polar solvent. So non-polar is dissolved in non-polar solvent. Polar, like polar covalent compound or ionic compound, both are polar, they are dissolved in polar solvent. So this is called like dissolve like. Now coming to the surfactants. Surfactants are the compound that reduces surface tension of a solvent. Surfactants have both a hydrophobic part and a hydrophilic part. Hydrophobic part is a part which is water fearing. Hydrophilic part is a part that is water loving, right? So surfactant break down hydrogen bonding network at the surface, and thus it acts like a surface tension reduction. So it allows polar solvent to mix with non-polar liquid like oil. So it reduces surface tension, it breaks the hydrogen bonds, and thus it allows polar solvent like water to mix in oils which are non-polar. It is acting as a cleaning agent. Soaps and detergents are the cleaning agent. These are surfactants. Detergents are formed of petrochemicals, right? These are petrochemicals. Now petrochemicals are the long molecules that have two ions when they dissociate. One of the ion is sodium ion, which is a cation. Mostly cations is sodium, right? So sodium ion is the cation usually. Now coming to the anion. Anion is a long chain with the charged head and long non-polar hydrocarbon tail. We have a hydrocarbon tail which is long, and then it is ended with a charged polar head, right? So this is my anion. Charged end of the anion is hydrophilic, right? Whereas the long hydrocarbon chain is hydrophobic. Hydrocarbon chain is non-polar, it is hydrophobic, whereas charged end is hydrophilic because it is polar and water is again polar. Now coming to the stain. Stain is mostly coming out of grease or oil, which is non-polar, right? So stain is attached to the hydrophobic end, right? So when the stain is attached to the hydrophobic end, when we are doing the the agitation of the cloth in the detergent and in water. So water molecules are agitated, water molecules are moving at a particular location, random location, and when the water molecules are moving, hydrophilic end is also moving. When the hydrophilic end is moving, it is pulling out the detergent ions with it, right? So water molecules is pulling out the stain ions with it. So whenever we are pulling out the hydrophobic part is attached to oil or grease, it is pulled out also with the water molecule. It detach oil stain from the cloth. It is covered by detergent. When the oil stain is pulled out, after pulling out, all of the surfaces, all of the ends of the oil are attached with the hydrophobic end of the detergent, and thus it avoids the reattachment of the stain to the cloth or the fabric. So now coming to the degree of saturation, we have the three types of solution: saturated solution. What is a saturated solution? Solution that contains maximum quantity of solute at a given temperature and pressure. That is my saturated solution. Then comes the unsaturated solution, solution in which more solute can dissolve at a given temperature and pressure. There is a quantity of solute that can add into the given solution at a given temperature and pressure, right? So this kind of solution is the unsaturated solution. When I have the maximum quantity of solute already added in the solution, that is the saturated solution. Now coming to the supersaturated solution, solution that contains more than the maximum quantity of solute that it should at a given temperature and pressure. So there is a maximum quantity of solute after which the solute cannot dissolve in the solvent at a given temperature and pressure, and after that it will precipitate out. So in the supersaturated solution, we have some solute that is precipitated out. We have some solute that is present at the bottom of the beaker as well. So now here, if I have a beaker, in the saturated solution, we have the solute already dissolved in the solvent, right? In the unsaturated solution, we have less solute dissolved in the solvent. We can add more solute over here. In the supersaturated solution, we have already maximum solute plus some of the solute is present at a precipitated form at the bottom of the beaker. Right, now coming to the solubility curve. Solubility curve is a graph of the solubility of a substance over a range of temperature. We have the different substances, and the solubility curves represent how the solubility of the substance is varying as I vary the temperature. I know when I increase the temperature, the solubility is going to increase. If I add sugar into water, if I increase the temperature, then I can add more sugar into the water, right? So if I have less sugar into the water, this is my unsaturated solution. If I have that much sugar into the water, after which it cannot be further added, so it is saturated solution. Coming to the supersaturated solution, in that kind of solution, we have some of the sugar which is precipitated at the bottom of the beaker in which the water is placed, right? So when I have the supersaturated solution, if I increase the temperature, we have this solute that can also move into the solution. So the precipitated sugar can also move into the solution in the supersaturated solution. So if I increase the temperature, solubility is going to increase. So based upon this, we have a question: a potassium sulfate solution K2SO4 aqueous containing 11.8 gram per 100 gram H2O at 20 degree Celsius is warmed to 60 degree Celsius. What additional mass of potassium sulfate is required to saturate this solution at 60 degree Celsius? So we have to see the point. 60 degree Celsius, 11.8 gram per 100 gram of H2O. Now if I see this in the solubility curve graph, you can see it is below the solubility curve. Saturation point at 60 degrees, 18.4 gram per 100 gram of H2O. So you can see this is unsaturated solution because we have lesser solute than the solute that is required to form a saturated solution. Now we can find out the difference. If difference is 18.4 gram per 100 gram of H2O minus 11.8 gram of solute per 100 gram of H2O, which is 6.6 gram per 100 gram of H2O. This is the amount of potassium sulfate required to make the saturated solution. If I add 6.6 gram potassium sulfate in this 100 gram of H2O, so I will get a saturated solution. Now coming to the amount concentration. Amount concentration is represented as C. It is amount in moles of solute dissolved per liter of solution. So amount of solute in mole divided by the volume of solution in liter is C is equal to N upon V. Its unit is mole per liter. Right? What is Stokes solution? Stokes solution is a concentrated solution used to prepare dilute solution for actual use. The concentrated solution which is used to prepare a dilute solution. So the most concentrated solution is the Stokes solution. Coming to the question based upon it. Sulfuric acid is a solution of hydrogen sulfate in water. When concentrated, it is highly corrosive. A 25 ml sample of concentrated sulfuric acid contains 44 gram of hydrogen sulfate. Calculate the amount of concentration of solution. We have to find out the concentration of solution. For that, we require the number of moles and volume. First of all, coming to the volume. Volume should be expressed in liters. Here the volume is present in milliliter. So we are going to multiply it with the conversion factor for the liter. So 25 ml into 1 liter divided by 1000 ml. It is 2.5 into 10 raised to power minus 2 liters. This is the volume of H2SO4. After that, we find out the number of moles of H2SO4, which is 44 gram into 1 mole divided by 98.08 gram, which is the molecular mass of H2SO4. We can find out the molecular mass of H2SO4 as 98.08 gram. So gram per mole. So here 44 divided by the molecular mass gives the number of moles, which is 0.4486 moles. Right. So now concentration is number of moles divided by the volume. So 0.4486 moles divided by 2.5 into 10 raised to power minus 2 liter, which is 18 mole per liter. So in this manner, we have understood some of the question based upon this chapter and some of the concepts also based upon the chapter water and solutions. I hope you are going to meet me soon in the next class of water and solutions. Thank you so much.